All right. Well, saints, let's look at Acts chapter 4. We're going to start off in verses 36 and 37. And we're going to read a little bit. Amen. And I want to introduce you to one of the members of the early church. And so we're going to talk about him a little bit. The Bible says, "And Joseph, who by the apostles was surnamed Barnabas, which is being interpreted, the son of consolation, a Levite of the country of Cyprus, having land, sold it, and brought the money and laid it at the apostles' feet." Father, we pray you add a blessing to the reading and the hearing and the exposition of your most holy word. Saints of God, last time we were here, amen, we talked about generosity. And we began to preach, amen, hallelujah, 3 points out of the book of Acts. The first point we talked about was great grace. And we saw a correlation, a connection between grace and how much we give to the Lord of our substance. Just like there's a connection between prayer and power, much prayer equals much power, much giving usually equates to much grace. And so if you want favor in your life, if you want grace in your life, then you want to be a giver. And I've noticed that the people who give the most, amen, hallelujah, they are usually the ones, hallelujah, that have the most favor. The second point we talked about was possessors of lands. As we talked about this point, amen, we saw that the early church actually liquidated, they sold some land that they had, some homes that they owned, some extra land, extra homes, to take care of the church. And that's in our text, amen, as well. And we began to talk about, amen, our giving and our tithing and how we should be like the early church and give, amen. But we notice that the church today is more about stuff, amen, than it is about its Savior, amen. Me and my wife were riding around just yesterday, and we saw that everywhere they building these new storage facilities, amen. They got storage buildings coming up everywhere, amen. And the storage buildings are like state of the art. I said, man, there must be some money in the storage business, amen. And so as I thought about that, I said, Lord, I said, man, people have more stuff today than any time in history. And that's why you got to build storage buildings, because people got too much stuff, amen, to hold at home, amen. Now look at this. Now, we're living in a time when we have more stuff than we ever had, but people most depressed than they've ever been. Anybody with me? All right. We the most medicated on medicine, can't get our mood right, our I mean, we all messed up, but we got the most stuff we ever had. So stuff is not the answer to satisfaction in life. Jesus is the answer, amen? And the early church saw this, and they saw that, amen, all that stuff that they was just hanging on to, that wasn't doing anything for them, it would be better if they would just take the stuff, sell the stuff, and bring the money to the church so that the money can build up. That's what they did. That's what they did in our text. You know what I'm saying? Because a lot of people want to hold on to stuff they don't need, but what you don't understand is you can't take that stuff with you. You can't take that stuff with you. If you don't need it, amen, then listen, give it, sell it, amen, and other people are going to be able to use it. But just don't hang on to stuff, all right? Like they used to say, they say, they never saw a U-Haul behind a hearse, amen? You can't take that stuff with you. But the early church had an understanding of that. If I'm not using it, I'm going to give it away, I'm going to sell it, and I'm going to let the church be able to use it. And the third point, they came and they brought it at the apostles' feet. This means that, amen, they came and they supported the church. The church didn't have to sell dinners, didn't wash cars, amen, didn't do this and do that, sell little candies and stuff like that. The Bible don't say that the church should do that at all. Amen. The church don't sell dinners to make it. Amen. Hallelujah. The church don't do that. The church relies upon God's people to do what God said, amen, and as they do what God said and tithe, that's what keep the church running, amen. They came, they laid it at the apostles' feet, and they trusted the apostles to do what was right with what they brought. A lot of people not giving, I ain't giving, they gonna do wrong with it. Listen, Listen, if you can't trust your pastor to do right with your tithe, then you're in the wrong church. You got to get someplace where you can give and feel comfortable about giving. Not giving is not the answer. Then you're going to stay broke. Then you're going to stay, amen, without grace and blessing. Not giving is not the answer. You know, if you can't trust your leaders, you go find you a place, a pastor that you can trust and you can give and feel comfortable that they're going to do what need to be done with the money in the church. Come on, give God some glory. Amen. They laid it at the apostles' feet meant that they didn't come and get it back, because some people use the church like free checking. They give their tithe, then they come right back and get it when the light bill due. You know what I'm saying? You don't want to do that. That's not tithing. Amen. That's not tithing. You just letting them people hold your money. That's free checking. All right? When you tithe, you give it so the church can build itself up, get the gospel out, keep the lights on, keep the message going. That's why we give. And so we talked about generosity last week. Come on, give God some glory. Amen. All right? So listen, this week we want to talk about a man by the name of Barnabas. Somebody say Barnabas. Yeah. We're going to talk about Barnabas. And you see, in verse 36 and 37, we introduced to him. All right? In verse 36 says, and Joseph, who by the apostles was surnamed Barnabas. His real name was Joseph, or as we would say, Joseph. That was his real name. And I heard one pastor say this about Joseph, that he was the church member of their dreams. That if any church member want to be a blessing to their church, they should look at Joseph or Barnabas and model their life after him. You see, that's how important he was, amen, that you would follow him as he followed Christ. Well, Pastor, why was Barnabas or Joseph such a blessing to his church? It's because he was an encourager. Somebody say an encourager. That's what Barnabas or Joseph was. You see, an encourager is somebody that gives support, confidence, hope, or help to someone. An encourager is somebody who helps stimulate or develops another individual. They give advice, pat on the back, whatever it is to keep people going, to get them to continue in, to continue fighting, and not to quit. That's an encouraging. Can I tell you that we all need a little encouraging sometimes? Amen. We all sometimes feel low, feel heavy. Amen. And it's one of the gifts, amen, I believe, that's probably one of the most needed in our church today. An encourager. And right here, we're going to look at Barnabas, man. And we're going to see how he was an encourager. He was such an encourager. He lifted people up wherever he went. When he walked in, if anybody was down, he was going to pick them up, lift them up. And when he left, they felt better about themselves. They felt better about God. They felt better about their future when Barnabas, or rather Joseph, had left. It was so bad that they changed his name. Remember, his name was Joseph. And they changed his name to what? To Barnabas. You see? Well, what does Barnabas mean? Barnabas literally means son of consolation. It means a comforter. It means an encourager. So they named the dude Encouragement because he was such an encourager. You see? I want to give you five ways today. Barnabas was an encourager. Five ways, five things that we can do, amen, to be the church member, amen, that we're supposed to be. First off, Barnabas was what we call a financial encourager. I'm not adding nothing to the scriptures right here when you look at it. Barnabas was a financial encourager. When you look at verse 36, the Bible says, and Joseph, who by the apostles was surnamed, nicknamed Barnabas, which is being interpreted the son of consolation, which is an encourager, a Levite, he's from the tribe of Levi, and from the country of Cyprus, that's what his nation was. What happened? Verse 37, having land, the Bible says, having land in verse 37. Let's look at verse 37, Sambu. Having land, what did Joseph do? What did Barnabas do? He sold it and brought the money and laid it at the apostles' feet. Barnabas was a financial encouragement. You see, Barnabas was just not about talking, all right? He was just not about acting like he was something in the church. Barnabas just didn't talk about it. He walked it out. Amen. We got some people, amen, they act like they own Philadelphia. You understand what I'm saying? They walk around here. If you sit in their seat, they're going to move you. You know what I'm saying? They in the far, they drinking coffee, they offering you some of the stuff. But fact of the matter is, they not tithers and they not givers. They offering stuff that they never put no money into. They offering stuff that they not partnered with. Amen. They talk a good game. Amen. But they not walking it out. You see, Barnabas put his money where his mouth was. Anybody hear me up in here? All right. All right. That's the kind of dude Barnabas was. All right. So what did he do? Listen, Barnabas had some land. And he took his land, and it was extra land. He sold it. He took the money. Amen. And he saw that the church had need. So he came and he brought it. All right. And that's what he did. You see? And that's an encouragement. In that day, the church was going through crunch time. 3,000 people get saved 1 week, 5,000. The next week, you got 8,000 new converts. Where you going to put all them people at? How you going to buy some Bibles for them people? What if the people need to eat or they need some place to stay? Peter, amen, just started the church and it was a mega church, over 8,000 members. He don't know what to do. And one of the things he needed was money to keep the church going. And guess who come up in there? Barnabas come up in there. And you don't think that that encouraged Peter when Barnabas come in there? You don't think if Peter felt like he was by himself, like, man, what am I going to do with all these people? How am I going to help these people out? How am I going to get a building to fit these people? What in the world am I going to do with all these people? And Barnabas come in there. Listen, I'm down with you, Peter. And to show that I'm down with you, look, I just sold some land over here, and I brought some of the money. I brought the money, and I'm laying it down, baby. I'm laying it down. I am with you. You understand what I'm saying? Do you know how encouraging that is for a pastor to have a people that's with him? And not just with him in their mouth, no. Because a lot of them, oh, pastor, we love you. Amen. Preach, pastor. And when the basket passed, ain't nothing shake. Now, just imagine if you had a man like that at home. I'm with you. Huh? I'm with you. Oh, yeah, you over there watching TV, doing everything, using all of your utilities, air condition, everything. He got his 72 up in there. Look, chilling. I'm with you, baby. I love you. I'm with you. But when the bills come due, huh? And you got to open all them bills by yourself and pay all them bills by yourself? You know, is he really with you? Not if he got a job and not if he just pocketing all the money. What I'm saying is you got to be an encouragement to your pastors. You can't just sit down and just take everything and everything like that and then leave the church leadership and the 200 that we have, leave us to carry the burden. You know what encouragement means? I'm going to come alongside and I'm going to grab an end of that thing. I might not be able to carry the whole thing, but I can carry a little piece. I can bring my portion. And it's not just me carrying it. It's not just the leaders carrying it. It's not just the 200 carrying it, but everybody carrying a little portion. Anybody hearing me up in here? You see? Now, when a pastor see that, that's encouraging. Could you imagine, Peter, when Barnabas come out there and lay that down? You see? You never know if Peter was on his last legs. Man, listen, we're going to shut it down. You know, I never know what Peter was saying. Man, listen, that's my last sermon I'm going to preach. We don't even know what to do with these people. Ain't nobody giving nothing. When you study the pastorate, you realize that a lot of pastors struggle. They struggle with depression. They struggle with, hallelujah, being encouraged. Because a lot of times they feel like they by themselves. Because when they got a big project, only a few people really come through. All right? You don't want to ever let your pastor feel like that. Like if anything going to get done, he got to do it himself. If anything going to get paid for, he got to pay for it himself. You want to be a financial encouragement to your pastor. You want to say, Pastor, I'm here. I might not make the money you make. I might not be this. I might not be that. But I'm coming with my two little mites, my two little pennies, and I'm going to add. I'm going to add. I'm going to carry my part of the burden. Oh, come on now. You see, Hebrews don't clap for stuff like that because they want everything for free. They want everything for free. Now, you ain't got no problem paying Cox, Verizon, AT&T, internet, cable. You ain't got no problem paying that, you know? Now, think about this for a second. What them things doing for you? They go down and they get a tie to cable. Their church is Cox Communications. That's where they church at. And Cox don't even have to pass a basket. They send the envelope to their house. All right? Now they take their tithe money that they're supposed to be giving to God. And they support Showtime, Movie Channel, Cinemax, Spike TV, TNT. They support all that that's putting filth on the TV. And when they come time to the end of the week on Sunday to come give their tithe, they ain't got nothing to give the Lord because they done gave the devil all their money. All right? Let me be real with you now. Now, God looking down from heaven, God saying, okay, you come to my church. You get my word. Listen, you learn how to be married. You learn how to raise your kids. But hallelujah, you go sit down in front of that TV and learn how not to be married, how not to raise your kids, how to lose your family, how to be on drugs, how to run the women. But you're going to send them your tithe. Oh, they quiet up in here today, baby. They quiet up in here today. Oh, yeah. They're going to pay that phone bill. Everybody got a phone in the house. Two-year-old, call him hello. Got his own line. Or 2 years old, got his own line. Everybody got a phone. Because I'm going to tell you, some people don't pay their tithes and don't give. Some of y'all, it's because y'all don't know the truth yet. And that's my job, to show you Malachi, show you the truth, show you how much God do for you. Then you say, okay, he command me to pay my tithe, I'm going to do it. Then some of y'all, you want to do it, but you can't. You done overextended yourself. And that's what the devil do. He got us paying everything but the one that we owe the most to. All right? Your two-year-old don't need that phone. That might be $30, $40, depending what kind of phone. You don't need all them channels. That might be $30, $40. And before you know it, you can get yourself in a position to where you're not a financial discouragement to the church you go to, but you're a financial encourager. Come on, give God some glory. Amen. God, make us a Barnabas, you see? Now let me talk to the Hebrews for a second. You see, in the white church, the Europeans, our brothers, they know something called stewardship. Stewardship. I wish I had, there it is, stewardship. Say that with me. Stewardship. See, us Hebrews done forgot what stewardship is. All right? You done forgot. That's why you're not a Barnabas yet. Barnabas understood stewardship. There's three things you need to understand about stewardship. Number one, everything you have don't belong to you. It does not belong to you. You think it's yours, but it's an illusion of control. It's not yours. Come on, put it up there. Number one, amen. Put it up there. You got to understand stewardship means God ownership. God owns everything. Psalm 24:1 says, the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. The world and what? And they that dwell therein. God owns everything. All right? He owns it all. He owns the body that you're living in. The hair on your head and the shoes on your feet. If God had to get mad with you, you'd leave out of here with nothing on today. You with me so far? Because he owns it all. And listen, if you play with him, he'll show you. He'll take it all from you. You leave here with nothing. So stewardship is coming to understanding that everything that I have has been given to me by God. And he still owns it. And I am just holding it for him. I'm managing it. I'm taking care of it. It's like somebody, a manager at Burger King. That's not their restaurant. They just taking care of the owner's, hallelujah, resources and his wealth and his place. You a manager today, all right? If you a manager, then you know that you better do what the owner wants you to do with what he gave you to manage. Woo! Woo! All right? We got to understand stewardship. Now, here it is. Deuteronomy 8:18. I just love that one. Listen, he said, listen, remember the Lord, God, for it is he that giveth thee power to get well. Anything you have, he gave you the power to do it. You know, oh, that's my money. That ain't your money. That's my house. That's not your house. That's the Lord's. All right? The second thing about stewardship is our responsibility. God's ownership, our responsibility. What does that mean, Pastor? Well, he allows us to manage it, but he makes us responsible. Look at Luke 12:48. Y'all know the scripture real good. I'm going to just quote it, half of it. Look, he says, for unto whomsoever much is given, of him shall much be required. And to whom men have committed much, of him they will ask the more. To whom much is given, much is required. Whatever God give you, he going to require something for it. All right? Well, Pastor, what does God inquire or require of me for what he's given me? You see? God requires, number one, that everything that he give you, you give him 10% off the top. God requires the tithe. I'm not going to be ashamed about it. I'm telling you the truth. The reason why you're broken, you're in the situation you're in, is because you're not doing what God wants with what he's given you, all right? When you learn to do what God wants with what he gave you, that's when the blessing's going to come. Remember I told you, amen, they will always be broke until they give me the tithe. Remember I told you that. And for me not to show you this principle would be to leave you in the condition that you're in. Number one, we tithe. We give it to him. He owns it all and just tell us, look, hey, I own it all, yeah, but just give me 10%. You can have the 90 and you can enjoy the 90. What kind of deal is that? Okay, Miss Michelle, you got $1,000. You walk up to this young lady right here and you give her that $1,000. And you say, it's mine, yeah, but you hold it. And you not only hold it, young lady, but you can have 900 of it. Spend it on yourself how you want. All I ask is that you give me 100 when I give you the 1,000. Young lady, would you take that 1,000 and give her 100? Yes, me, yes, sir, I would. That's the deal that God give us. That's the deal he give us. I will give it to you. You give me a little portion so I can keep my work going. And you could spend the rest. You could ball on the rest. You could have a good time. You can get whatever car you want, whatever house you want. You could have a good time. Just give me what's mine off the top. Is that not a good deal? Oh, come on, give God some glory now. Come on now. Our responsibility. Number one, we tithe. Number two, we offer. And that means this. God, all God requires is the tithe, is the 100. But some people, amen, they so blessed by what God has done. When God give them the 1,000, all they got to do is give God 100. They say, take 150, God. You know what I'm saying? You've been that good. Instead of 900, I'm going to take 850, God, because, listen, that's just from me. I know what's required of me, but that's just from me. We require to tithe. We require to offer. We require to take care of the poor around us. I'm talking about God's ownership and our responsibility. We got to take care of the poor around us. And number four, we got to fund his projects. And I'm going to talk with you about that. Miss Michelle goes, she give the young lady the 1,000. The young lady give Miss Michelle 100. And she said, Miss Michelle, God, hallelujah, I'm going to not only give you my 100, but look, here, 50 for being so good to me. All right? Now, she got 850, you know. She going out, she getting groceries, she doing her thing. She done got all her stuff ready and everything like that. She still got like 500 left. She's sitting good. Sitting good. The next level of giving is when God whispers something to you. He don't do that to everybody, but he whispers something to you. A need come up somewhere on the planet, somewhere in your vicinity. And one of God's children or one of God's churches needs something. And they fall on their knees and they pray. They say, God, we need a breakthrough. We can't pay this bill or we need this, God, and we need a breakthrough. Some child of God somewhere, can you see it? On their knees in their closet. And God look out and God say, which one of my stewards, my servants, is blessed and I know got a giving heart? So God in the spirit, this servant praying over here, needing something, needing a breakthrough. God, amen, talk to homegirl again. I don't know your name, so I'm just saying homegirl. Hallelujah. God, talk to her again. All right? Now, she's sitting fat. She got all her stuff. She done tied, gave her stuff. She's sitting. She got 500 sitting there. All right? God speak to his servant. He praying on that. God say, I need you again. What you need, Lord? Look, it's all yours. Listen, take 25 of it and go down here on such and such street and drop it off over here because somebody ain't got nothing to eat today. You with me so far? That's that next level. That's that next level. So she look out now. He done gave her 1,000. All right? She got all groceries. She gave 100 back, 150 back. Some people be like, I done already tied them ready off. I ain't giving nothing. But the real folk that can hear that next level, oh, no, got 25. That's all you want? That's all you want? That's all you want? You go up in there. You know what I'm saying? And you get that 25. Now, this person on their knees now. They don't know where it's going to come from. They're like, Lord, I just need it, God. We ain't got nothing to eat. My son crying up in here. And lo and behold, God done woke a servant up right when they on their knees. He could have go to the door. Listen, I don't know you and you don't know me, but God just told me that you needed $25. And I don't know why I'm doing this, but I've been blessed. And I just want to be faithful with what he gave me. Stewardship is understanding ownership. Whose ownership? God's ownership. Our responsibility to manage it like he tell us to manage it. And when you get to a place where you tithe, you offer, you give to the poor, God's going to graduate you because you'll be in a place and God's going to speak to you. God's going to say, give this. And the first time God tell you that, you're going to look up, God's going to say, give 50. You're going to say, the devil is a liar. I'm already tired. The devil is a liar. I was someplace, man, the Lord said, give 1,000. I said, Lord, that ain't you. I said, that ain't you, Lord. And I wrote the check. An offering came and went. I tried to put that thing in the offering. It didn't come out of my hand. The preacher started. I still got the check in my hand. They go in the back to count all that. I still got the check in my hand. I go to the altar to celebrate. I still got the check in my hand. I'm walking out the sanctuary. Guess where the check was? Still in my hand. So finally, I get to the place where, God, that was you. But, they already done left. They say, sir, everybody done left already. You know? Thank God I was going to come back tomorrow. It was a conference. And I was able to give it then. But I learned something. All right? It's his. He going to tell you what to do with it. And when he tell you to do something, go ahead and do it. Now listen, that's not the only thing about stewardship. That's not the best part. Ownership, responsibility, reward is number 3. Reward. You see, because when our sister is obedient to God and go to that door, and feed one of God's children. He said, what you've done to the least of these, my brother, you have done it unto me. When she is obedient with that little $25, and she go over there and she knock, and she get that $25, guess what God do? Now, we playing like Miss Michelle, and guess what God do? He see that, and he look at that, and he say, man, she was faithful with that $1,000. She tithed 100, gave 50 offering, and gave 25 when somebody really needed something. Now, what you think God going to do when she was faithful with that 1,000? Guess what? God going to walk up there again. He going to say, you was faithful with that 1,000? Sister, here 2,000. You see what I'm saying? All right. Y'all don't believe me? Y'all don't believe me? You ever heard the scripture? Listen, it's in Matthew 25. If you've been faithful with little, you will be made faithful with much. The problem that we having is that the little that God has given you, you're not faithful with it. You spend it on all the wrong things, and you're doing all the wrong things with it. And when God looked out and he said, well, I gave her 1,000 and she wasn't faithful with it. Well, I ain't going to give her 2. Some of y'all saying, God, I need more. But God's saying, you're not faithful with what I gave you. It'd be kind of like you lend somebody your bike. And they wreck your bike, tear it up, come back flat. You know what I'm saying? And then when they bring your bike back in that condition, they say, you know what? Can I borrow your car? You'd be like, boy, you tripping. You couldn't even handle my bike. Why in the world would I give you a car? You couldn't even handle $24,000 a year. Why are you praying for 100? Barnabas wasn't like that. He was a financial encouragement, and he was faithful to what God had given him. He was a tither. He was an offerer. But when God even spoke to him, give this, do this, he didn't second guess God. He did what he was supposed to do. And anytime we do that, we're an encouragement to our church, to our leadership, and to the people around us. And we wind up getting more blessed the more we give. Come on, give God some glory. Amen. Woo! Secondly, Barnabas was not only an encouragement financially, he was an encouragement to new Christians. Hallelujah. We're just doing a little portrait of Barnabas, and I'm going to show you, amen, through the scriptures, amen, little snapshots of his life, little selfies of his life, amen. And in Acts 9 and 26, we see Barnabas again. The Bible says, and when Saul was come to Jerusalem, he essayed to join himself to the disciples, but they were all afraid of him and believed not that he was a disciple. Now listen, let me give you a little bit of history about this person that they call Saul or Paul in verse 26. This Saul, as we would call him Paul today, he was a persecutor of the church, meaning that whoever was a Christian, he hated them. The Bible says that he locked people up in jail that were Christians. He was down with them being stoned and killed. And, you know, he dragged them out their houses. He was a real bad fella to Christians. All right. And one day, Paul says, listen, I heard they even got some Christians in Damascus. And so Paul get a letter from the high priest. He say, I'm going to Damascus and I'm going to get them Christians because they no good. And I'm going to drag them back to Jerusalem. That was his plan. But the Bible said many are the plans of a man, but it's the ways of the Lord that decided. You see what I'm saying? So Paul on his way to Damascus on his high horse. And the Bible says about noonday, hey God, he looked up in the sky and he saw something shining brighter than the noonday sun. It was the Lord Jesus. And Jesus was shining so bright, he knocked Paul off his horse. And he asked Paul, he said, Paul, why are you persecuting me? Paul said, who are you, Lord? He said, Jesus Christ, whom thou persecutest. He said, listen, Paul got up, he got his stuff, went into Damascus. He was blind at that time, got saved, amen, hallelujah. And all of a sudden now, he not persecuting Christians no more. Paul has become a Christian. All right? The same ones that talk bad about it. God will put you in a position, hey, to make you preach the same faith that you used to talk about. That's my testimony. That's my testimony. You used to talk bad about the Bible, look, preaching the Bible. You see? But God will knock you off your high horse. You see? So, man, listen, man. So Paul out there in Damascus, he started preaching. He preaching and teaching so good to where they want to kill him now. The Christians in Damascus say we can't get him outside the city because they're waiting on him. They take a basket and they lower Paul down the wall of the city in a basket. Paul hit the ground, he run. Where does he run? He run to the next city, Jerusalem. He run to Jerusalem. All right? He get to Jerusalem, Tyrone. He can't go by his old friends because he's saved. Now he a Christian. Everybody he knew hated Christians, but now he a Christian. He can't hang with nobody, don't have no friends, nothing like that. So Paul said, listen, I'm going to go and I'm going to hook up with some Christians. When Paul tried to hook up with some Christians, and Saul was come to Jerusalem, and he has said he tried to join himself to the disciples. But what happened? They were all afraid of him. Why? Because they believed not that he was a disciple. They took Paul's pass, and they judged Paul by his pass. And none of them wanted to be close to him. He was a baby Christian. He was a new believer. He probably had questions that he needed answered. He probably felt some things in his heart. Should I do this or should not do this? And he needed somebody who was further along in the faith to talk to. But everybody pushed him away because of who he used to be. All right? I wonder how many people in here today come to church, get saved, but good Christians push you away because of what you used to be, because of how you look right now, because of how you dress right now, because of the things you do right now, because you're not at that level where they're at right now, but you saved and you love God, but you're just not all the way there just yet. They didn't want to take Paul in. But the Bible says in the next verse, 9 and 27, I love this, but Barnabas. Woo! That's my boy there. We're talking about him. But Barnabas did what? Took him in. You see? I wonder if we got some Barnabases up in here today. Huh? Where a new believer can come in. Huh? New believer come in. They just got saved. They still dressing like the club. Gold teeth tatted up. Huh? Are we going to judge them when we see them because they look like the street? Huh? Are we going to judge them and say, nah, I can't get with them. I can't be with them. They coming in. They got all kind of questions. We not even looking at them. We don't tell them hi. I tell you, hug three people, say, God is a good father. You hugging three. You see them, you go the other way. Well, that's not how Barnabas was. That's not how Barnabas was. Barnabas took him where? Took him in. You see? He was an encouragement to new Christians. Listen to me. Are you a Barnabas here? Are you a Barnabas? Are you an encouragement to new believers? You know? We got a lot of people too concerned with the past of other people. And they don't know that they had a past too. And the same God that took them out is able to take this new believer out. But we saw distrusting. They was nervous about Paul. Suspicious about him. You know? I wonder how many people feel like that when they come to Philly. You know? Nobody talk to them. Nobody tell them hi. You know? Listen to me. In the black church, this is a big problem. In the Hebrew church. Me and my wife, we done been to all kind of churches. White churches, black churches. And the black church is a big problem. I remember going to some European churches, some white churches, amen. And listen, they had a brother there, man, Brent Pelliquin. I go in there, me and my wife, my family. Brother, hallelujah, invite me over. Talk to me, man. Give me his number and stuff. You remember Brent, Brother G? You know what I'm saying? We just getting started moving in our house, man. They gave us a refrigerator, man. Jarvis bought a car from Brent. You know what I'm saying? Just a fellowship. Listen, hi, I'm Brent. I'm a Christian. You new here. But that's all right. We can hook up. I can show you the ropes. You know? But black churches, we terrible at that. We come to church for us. We ain't looking to the side, looking to the left or the right. We ain't coming to know nobody, nothing. Now, we coming to show our outfit, but we don't want to talk to nobody. All right? We want everybody to know we look good. Dad, talk to me now. You see what I'm saying? My wife tell me all the time, look, she first lady over here. Tell people how. People are like, hi. We don't want to tell each other. Nobody want to tell each other nothing. And when we talk to each other, listen, and it's on both sides. The ones that been here don't want to talk. The ones that's just coming don't want nobody to talk to them. Ooh, they talking to me. They told me hi. That girl asked me for my number. What's wrong with her? What she want? We so suspicious of one another. You know where that come from? Willie Lynch. That's where that come from. Like crabs in a bucket, pulling each other down, hate each other. Suspicious of each other, can't trust each other. You know? And that stuff is still with us, and it's in the black church. No connections. And some people come here, man, they come here for months, and nobody ever told them hi. You know? And we got to deal with that stuff. One of the reasons we like that is because we don't like the way we look. They done taught us to look in the mirror and not like the way we look. We look in the mirror and we distrust our own image. Because somebody with a nose like us, we distrust. Somebody with a hair like us, we distrust. Listen, this is not the image of somebody that's trustworthy. It's not the image of somebody I want to my house. The funny thing is that image is you. Woo! You'd be surprised at the test they give. My wife was showing me one of them little psychological tests they give kids. And it was showing who's the good people and who's the bad people. And they would dress them and color them a certain way. All the kids, white and black kids, pick white kids as the good kids and black kids as the bad kids. Now, I don't even mind white kids doing that. But the real problem is when our own kids, woo, gonna put that they can't even trust. And you think I'm crazy for tripping out on you about TV and internet. Because all the heroes and the stars and the millionaires and the ballers, they don't look like you. It's to brainwash your mind. To show you that your hair, the way it is not what a star look like. Your nose, the way it is not what a hero, a difference maker look like. So when we go to talk to each other and do business with each other, we got this thing in our heart against each other. Let them people come talk to you, your voice change. Hey, how are you doing? You put on a different voice. Why we hate each other like that? Why we hate each other like that? So much so we won't talk to each other. In church. I'm looking for some Barnabases, man. Some people that's going to look out in the audience and say, who knew at church? I never saw him before or her before. And it's not about maybe moving too fast. You don't ask them their social security number first time you see them. They're going to think you're cultish. But what about hello? My name is Laquita Isha Nanita. You know what I'm saying? Hey, I'm Ram Shaka, Babalaka, you know. A name exchange for the first time. Second time, hey, man, listen, you know, what you doing after church? Maybe we can go get a bite to eat. You see? There was this little girl, she was way to church. And her mom was, you know, letting her get ready. She was going to a special evening service. And mama told her, mama said, now listen, don't you just go to church for you. Look out for somebody. The Lord's going to send somebody your way that needs you. So she went to church and she sat in that, and the message was booming. It was good and everything like that. And then all of a sudden she heard her mama voice in her ear. Don't you dare just come here for yourself. Look out for somebody else that may need you. And sitting not too far from her was a new visitor. A young lady about her same age. And she was shy, so she didn't want to go talk with her, but she kept hearing, don't you just come here for yourself. She walked up to the new visitor, introduced herself, and they began to click-clack. Boy, they connected. Next thing you know, they meeting outside of church, going places, amen, hallelujah, and a friendship just blew up. Young lady wound up getting saved. That new visitor got saved. Became a member of that church. Amen. Got married in that church. Amen. Raised some good godly kids in that church. Amen. Her grandchildren was full of Christ. Amen. Her great-grandchildren were full of Christ. Amen. All the way to four generations. And they asked that new visitor later on. They said, man, what was the key to your success? You got four generations of Christians. Y'all faithful in the church. Hallelujah. What happened? What was the secret? She said, that one day that such and such came, talked to me, and took me in, and loved on me, and made me a friend. She said, that changed my life, and it changed my husband's life, it changed my children's life, and it changed my grandchildren's life. You would be surprised. See, some of y'all think that, hallelujah, the great work is up here. You think the great work is up here and some of the God and everything like that. Oh, I want to preach up here. When God is saying they got somebody sitting right next to you that need a word. Oh, God. Oh, God. Barnabas took Paul in and began to minister to him and began to bless him. I had a Barnabas in my life, a guy by the name of Corey Babin. Took me in. Blessed me. What Christianity was all about. How did he show you, Pastor? We just rode around together. If he was going here, I went with him. We went shoot ball together. We did this together. We just chilled together. He said, Pastor, how did he give you Christianity just chilling with you? Listen to me. Not all the time you got to hear what Christian know, no. Sometimes you got to see what they know. You got to see how they live. You see, baby Christians not only need to hear a scripture quoted, they need to see a scripture lived out. And Corey would live the scripture in front of me. He showed me what it was like, amen, to not be looking at a woman that was passing. How to deal with a woman that was trying to holler at you when you knew you was holding yourself for the Lord. He showed me what it was like, amen, to go to church, amen, even though other things were scheduled and no, but Sunday's my most important day. I saw it lived in him. And when I saw it lived, I was able to transfer it from his life into my life. You with me so far? Oh, God. Yeah, because we got some of y'all saying, I don't know enough scripture to take somebody in. You ain't got to memorize that. Just live it out. Come on, give God some glory. Amen. All right. Y'all, we got to move. Here's the third point. The third way Barnabas was an encouragement. He was an encouragement in new works. New works. Amen. And in Acts 11 and 19, amen, the Bible tells, now they which were scattered abroad upon the persecution that arose about Stephen traveled as far as Phoenix and Cyprus and Antioch, preaching the word to none but unto the Jews only. When the church first was born, persecution happened. Like I say, Paul was doing his thing to Christians, but other people began to persecute Christians just because of our belief in Christ. And so because of that persecution, the Hebrews began to scatter all over the Middle East and the Mediterranean portions of Europe. Scattered because of persecution, they only was witnessing to other Hebrews, other Judeans. You see? But in verse 20, the Bible says, and some of them were men of Cyprus and Cyrene, which when they had come to Antioch, They spake unto the Grecians. And what was they preaching? Preaching the Lord Jesus. Now, Pastor, who's the Grecians? You just told me. They scattered out of Jerusalem. They was preaching all into other Judeans and Hebrews that looked like them. Amen. But all of a sudden, they began to preach to the Grecians. The Grecians are the Greeks. Whites. It's Mediterranean. You see? Dark hair. They began to preach. The Hebrews began to preach the gospel to them. Began to preach to the Grecians. You see? And listen to me right here. The Bible says they received it. In 21, and the hand of the Lord was with them, and a great number of them believed and turned unto the Lord. Now, this is awesome. Because right there, Tyrone, God is doing a new thing. Remember, it was always his plan to use the Hebrews as a light to gather the other nations. And after they crucified the Lord, amen, they rejected him. But the gospel was supposed to be preached to Judea first. But then, Brother Gray, hallelujah, to all the nations of the world. Right here we see in the spillover. Out of the Hebrews into the other Gentile races. The spillover. I'm going to preach it. You're going to catch it. All right? It's a spillover. Other nations are coming to Christ now. All right? It's a beautiful thing. It's a new dispensation. It's a new phase of the church that's walking in, being walked in right now. The first phase that, listen, all the disciples were here, the first step. This is another step right here. Gentiles and Europeans starting to get saved. I'm going to show you the third step in a second. You see? Well, they started a church. The Europeans started a church. The church was called Antioch. Somebody say Antioch. That's the church, all right? And it was booming over there. And the disciples saw that. They said, man, listen, we got to send somebody to go check on that church. In verse 22, look what it says. Then tidings, news of these things came into the ears of the church, which was in Jerusalem. And they sent forth who? Barnabas, that he was as far as Antioch. Now, this is good, Joe. This is good. When you got a new work like this, you can't just send anybody to go see about it. Because everything is different. Barnabas leaving Jerusalem church, and he going to the Antioch church, and all the people look different. All the music is different. The dress is different. The hairstyles is different. The preaching is different. Everything is different. And you can't just send no anybody into a different place that don't tear it up. You see, us, we got a problem. If they're not doing it our way, then it ain't good enough. If they got drums on the stage when we used to the piano, it's not good enough. If they singing hymns when we used to, amen, singing Travis Green, it ain't good enough. Somebody thought I'd say Al Green. I say Travis Green. If we used to coming in jeans and they wearing suits, it's not good enough. If we used to afros and they got their hair laid down, it ain't good enough. What I'm saying is that Barnabas was able to walk in that church with different people, different customs, different church, and he was still able to see God. Come on, give God some glory. Come on. All right. The Bible says in verse 23, who when he came, what happened? He had seen the grace of God and was glad. Barnabas walked in there and saw him doing everything different, but he could still see the grace over there. The favor of God, the love of God, the support of God. And the Bible says that Barnabas was glad. That means that Barnabas wasn't a hater. He didn't want just Jerusalem church to be the one that was blowing and going. And while the other churches wasn't doing nothing, nah, he saw the grace of God on the churches of these other nations, and he was glad. The Bible says not only that, amen, he saw the grace of God, he was glad. Let me look at my notes right here. And the Bible says, amen, and he exhorted them all. He encouraged the new church. This is good. Somebody, the wrong person going in here would have tore that church up. Y'all stop preaching like that. Stop teaching like that. Stop dancing like that. That music too loud. There's too much drums in that music. God don't like Zydeco. God don't like Christian rap. God don't like Christian Zydeco. We began to put our own preferences on people. Just because you don't like Christian rap don't mean that somebody can't be edified from it. You see what I'm saying? Just because you don't like Christian Zydeco don't mean nobody can be edified from it. You see? But Barnabas was able to go in there and see the grace of God. He was glad. He encouraged them. And the only thing he told them was this: y'all cleave unto the Lord. Stay close to Jesus. That's what he told them. Listen, Philly, my prayer is that the other churches would see that in Philadelphia. I know we a different church, a very controversial church. I know that we got the Hebrew doctrine and we believe that we the Israelites of the Bible. I understand that, you know, and people might not agree with that. But what I wish they would do is do like Barnabas. I don't care if you think different. I don't care if you don't, if you disagree with it. Come and see what's going on. And as they come and see what's going on, if they like Barnabas, they're going to see the grace of God upon it. They're going to see his favor on it, his support in it, the blessing on it. Listen to me. Listen to me. You got to be able to do that. And I'm praying, Mike, that some of our other pastors will be able to do that. You know? Come in and see. Come see the Hebrews getting off of drugs. Come see the Hebrews getting jobs and supporting themselves. Come see the Hebrews getting off of welfare and food stamp. Come see the Hebrews opening up business. Come see them being faithful to their wives, being plugged into their families. Listen, Pastor Omar, we don't believe you. We don't agree with you. But one thing we know, the grace of God is here, and we're glad because you're changing the people. You're changing the people. That's all I'm asking for. That's all I'm asking for. Barnabas had a heart like that. He supported new works. And I pray to God that, hallelujah, we could be like that as well. Come on, give God some glory. Amen. Keep on going, Pastor. He was a financial encouragement. He encouraged new believers. He encouraged new works. But he also encouraged new leaders. New leaders. In Acts 11 and 25, I love this. Now, Antioch is cutting up. They can't find enough seats in the church of Antioch. That European churches, look, I mean, revival is happening in it. And Barnabas is the head of that church. He's the leader of it. He's overseeing it. And everything is going well. They making so much, hallelujah, souls, so they making so much money, souls getting saved. They was able to send money back to Jerusalem to help the Jerusalem church. That's how blessed Antioch was. They was able to help the Jerusalem church who was in famine. It's at that time when the Jerusalem, when the Antioch church is most blessed, that Barnabas does this. Then departed Barnabas to Tarsus. Who did he go get? For to seek who? Saul. What's another name for Saul? That's right. He went get Paul. He went get Paul. He went get Paul. This is deep. You see, most people, when something is successful under them, they ain't worried about getting nobody else to come help them, no. Oh, no, that's my church. Ain't gonna be nobody else doing this and nobody else doing that. They're not trying to raise nobody up, help nobody out. Listen, that's me, that's mine. No other preachers, no teachers, no nothing. It's going good, we're going to leave it like that. But you know what Barnabas did? Barnabas had a church that was lively and doing good, and he looked out, he said, well, who else could I get to help me lead this thing? Who else can I develop and grow them up to be leaders? That's the heart of Barnabas. Not a heart of selfishness, not a heart of selfish ambition, but a heart to say, who else can come and lead with me? He went get Paul. Verse 26, and when he found him, he brought him unto Antioch. And it came to pass that the whole year they assembled themselves with the church. And what did Paul and Barnabas do? They taught much people, and the disciples were called Christians first at Antioch. Listen to me. Are you a Barnabas this morning? Do you develop leaders? Or are you only concerned with your position? I don't know who you are. You're a 12 leader, a ministry head? Are the people under you growing? Are you making them ready to be 12 leaders themselves, ministry heads themselves? We got to be like Barnabas, and we got to be an encouragement, amen, to new converts, but Christians who've been down a little while, but we got to say, okay, you're in the faith. Now, come on, come up with me. You ready for your own 12. You ready for your own ministry. Hey, God. That's how Barnabas was. But you see, to be like Barnabas, can't be selfish. You got to be about the kingdom. To be like Barnabas, you can't be self-conscious. You got to be sure in who you are. We got a lot of pastors and preachers won't raise nobody else up on the side of them or under them because they're so scared that somebody going to come up and do a better job than them. And that ain't nothing but from the devil. Amen. If somebody do a better job than you, then you should look, praise God. Now I got somebody that can give me a break. You understand what I'm saying? I got somebody I can plant another church with. That's the heart of Barnabas. But you can't be self-conscious. You got to be secure in who you are and what you do for God. All right? Every single one of us we've received a gift. And we have a gift and we have a certain assignment. You're not going to do more than that assignment. And God, hope to God, you don't do less than that assignment. All right? So if you know that, then listen, be you. Do what God called you to do. And do the best at that. But at the same time, raise other people up who may be lower than you, may end up being greater than you, but that's not your business. You run your race. Ooh, come on, somebody. The church need help, man. Don't want to help no other brother get up. They scared somebody going to pass them up. And if they pass them up, listen, you should say glory to God. The kingdom is going to be blessed for it. Miss Carol, in the beginning of this, they called it Barnabas and Paul. Barnabas and Paul. Barnabas developed Paul so much into such a great leader. In the book of Acts, we're going to start reading. It's going to stop saying Barnabas and Paul. It's going to start saying Paul and Barnabas. He's going to exceed his disciple. He's going to exceed his teacher. And that's okay. Woo! And that's okay. This is not capitalism. This ain't American business world where we keep the people that's our competition down. This is the church. We try to pass the baton to somebody faster than us. It's a relay race. And you want to get to that last leg and you want to put that baton into somebody's hand that can really move. Because you know if that anchor grabbed that baton and they faster than even you was, maybe we might win the race. Come on, somebody. Hey, God, it's a relay race. So Barnabas developed leaders, y'all. He encouraged them. That's what he did with Paul. He went and get him. He said, Paul, come on, man. I got some work for you to do. I see something in you. We can use you. Amen. Hallelujah. And that's what he did. Let me see what else I have for you. Hallelujah. All right, here's the last point. Lastly, Barnabas was an encouragement to our fallen brothers and sisters, to our fallen soldiers. Let me show you something else about Barnabas. In Acts 15, verse 35, look what it tells us about him. Look, there it goes again. Look, in 35, Paul and who? And Barnabas. Just what I told you, it's about to flip. Paul is the greater now. Paul and Barnabas continued in Antioch, teaching and preaching the word of the Lord with many others also. And some days after, Paul said unto Barnabas, let us go again and visit our brethren in every city where we have preached the word of the Lord and see how they do. Paul and Barnabas was such a great, great team. They planted churches in Antioch, but they didn't stop there. They went to all kinds of different places planting churches. And so Paul says, Ms. Linda, Paul says, hey, Barnabas, let's go and visit all our different churches again. Make sure how they doing, see how they doing, everything like that. You know? The next verse say this. Hallelujah, 37. And Barnabas said, cool, let's go. But can we bring John Mark with us? Barnabas determined to take with them John, whose surname was Mark. Barnabas said, yeah, but we're going to take John Mark. Now, what some of y'all don't know is that John Mark had went on a trip with Paul and Barnabas before, the first trip. And on the first trip, when it got a little too rough out there, John Mark said, won't go home. I won't go home. They stoning people out here. You know what I'm saying? I'm on this ship, and I'm throwing up, and I won't go home. I want my bed. I want my mama. All right? That's what happened the first time. Paul got offended by that. We took you on the trip. We brought you with us. You had a responsibility to do, and we're trying to get the gospel out. This is about the souls of men, and you worried about going home? So back to what we talking about. Paul said, let's go check out the other church. Barnabas said, good. Let's bring John Mark. Paul said, huh? Huh, bro? You wasn't there when he bailed out on us? You wasn't there when he left us high and dry? What you mean bring John Mark? Look at the next verse. I'm telling you, it was Paul. But Paul thought it not good to take him. Why? He departed from them, from Pamphylia, and went not with them to the work. He let them down before. He had failed them. And Paul said, we're not taking you. But it's something about Barnabas, y'all. He was not only encouraging finances, new works, new converts, amen. Not only encourager, amen, to new leaders. But he was an encourager to brothers and sisters who had fallen down, hallelujah, who had disobeyed, amen, not done the right thing, time or a season. Barnabas was that type of Christian that would look at a brother and say, yeah, you messed up, but I'm going to give you another chance. You're going to come with me, amen, hallelujah, and we're going to get this thing right. He was a Christian, amen, that gave people a second chance. You see what I'm saying? And we need Barnabas today. You see, the Bible tell us, amen, that he was set on bringing Barnabas. I mean, he was set on bringing John Mark. You see? And it got so bad, look at the next verse, hallelujah, in verse 39, that they started fussing about it. Paul and Barnabas start fussing about it. Now, the funny thing about this is this, right? Paul is mad at Barnabas for doing what he had did for Paul. Showing him grace and mercy and taking him in when nobody wanted him. He was mad at Barnabas for doing just what Barnabas had done to him. When everybody else was giving up on you, Paul, I was there for you. So I'm taking John Mark. No, you're not. I'm taking him. No, you're not. What you want to do? What you want to do, son? That's just in my mind. All right? The contention was so sharp between them that they departed asunder. They separated Paul and Barnabas. They broke up like New Edition. You see what I'm saying? They broke up. And so Barnabas did what? He took Mark and he sailed to Cyprus. He said, listen, I don't care who tell me not to give you another chance. I don't care who tell me not to show you grace. I'm going to show you grace, and I'm going to show you mercy. No, you didn't do right this time. But you're going to be what God wants you to be. Barnabas was an encourager to our fallen brothers and our fallen sisters. Listen, let me ask you a question. Are you a Barnabas to people around you? Huh? Do you give a little space for grace to people around you? Do you give a little space for them to say the wrong things and do the wrong things and maybe fall short every now and then? Are you a Barnabas to your children? Are you a Barnabas to your friends? Are you a Barnabas to people in your ministry? Are you a Barnabas on the job? Are you a Barnabas in this church? Or do you hold people to a perfect standard? And once they mess up, you wash your hands with them and you're done with that? Are you a bridge builder or a bridge burner? You understand what I'm saying? Are you a Barnabas? See, listen to me. All of us make mistakes. All of us fall short of the glory. And all of us, amen, there's none righteous, no, not one. We do that type of stuff, Leah. We do. But every now and then, we need some people, amen, to look at us in our mess and say, look, God not done with you yet. God not done with you yet. And since he not done with you, I'm not done with you. I'm going to give you a second chance. That's how Barnabas got down. I pray to God we had some Barnabases up in here. Listen to me. I'm happy that Barnabas stood. Now, I'm upset that him and Paul break friendship and break partnership. But I'm sure glad. I'm sure glad that he made this decision to stick with John Mark. Listen to me. Barnabas is an awesome developer of people. He pull them up out the ground, man, out the dumpster, and raise them all the way up. He did it for Paul, and Paul became a leader. And those that might not know, Paul wrote 2/3 of the New Testament. Those books, Romans, amen, Galatians, Ephesians, amen, Colossians, Philemon, Paul wrote all of that. Paul wrote all of that, all right? Now, we all look at Paul, we say, wow, Paul. But we forget about the person who developed Paul. And that was Barnabas. All right? But Paul wasn't the only Bible writer that Barnabas developed. You see this here, John Mark? That nobody wanted to go with? See this here, John Mark? Give up on? You know when you open your New Testament? They got 4 Gospels. Just 4 of them that tell the life of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. One of them is written by Matthew. The next one is written by Mark. That's that John Mark. Barnabas took that boy who was good for nothing, raised him up, developed him, pulled him out of his mess, gave him a second chance, made him a titan in the church. When you read about it, Peter was even partner with John Mark because he was that much of a soldier. You see? Then that boy come out there and pen. He write that gospel of Mark that we have. He got so blessed and so useful in the church. In 2 Timothy chapter 4, amen, the Bible tells us that a change happened in Paul when he began to look. Come on, Sambu, bring me that scripture in Timothy. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. They must have fell asleep. Listen. In Timothy, 2 Timothy 4, verse 11. I'm going to read it to you. Hallelujah. Come on. We need to read it. We need to read it. 2 Timothy 4. Hallelujah. All right. Let's act like it's up there. Look what Paul writes about. Amen. Maybe it's the computer that's sleeping. Look what Paul writes about John Mark. I remember. He didn't even want John Mark to go with him. But look what happened when Barnabas finished with him. Paul is in prison. He says, only Luke is with me. Thank you, Father. Only Luke is with me. He said, take Mark and bring him with thee, Timothy. Now listen. He wasn't good enough for you before, Paul, but after Barnabas got a hold of him. Now you're asking Timothy, take Mark, bring him with thee. For he is profitable. The very one that you thought was good for nothing. Now Paul is recanting that statement. He is profitable. To who? To me. He's profitable to me for what? For the ministry. Come on, give God some glory. Barnabas restored him, built him up, and helped him. Listen, I wonder if there's some people around you that don't have it all right just yet, but they're waiting for a Barnabas to come in their life. And you might be just that Barnabas they're waiting for, where you can come in a brother's life and salvage him, be with a sister and restore her. Now listen, it's a very dangerous game. You got to understand that. Because you're going to have some people that don't want it. You're going to have some people that's fakers. You're going to have some people that's tares and wool and sheep's clothing. But the disciple or the developer got to have the discernment to be able to see who to stick with and who to leave. All right? Because you don't want to cast your pearls to swine. But at the same time, if you see somebody trying and legitimately
wanting to serve the Lord. Now, the people that's out there just fake jacking and cutting up, nah, cut your ties with that. But people like John Mark, who want to do right, but every once in a while do wrong, but they want to do right, all right? You take that and you develop, you build that up, and you're going to have your somebody, hallelujah, who can lead the church. Come on, give God some glory, amen? Woo! So, saints of God, Barnabas was an encourager. And I pray that you be an encourager, too. In finances, hallelujah, with new Christians, hallelujah, with new works, glory to God, and also with new leaders, and glory to God, people who fall around you into sin or anything else. Father, we thank you so much for your word. And we pray that it's a word and your people can grow by it, that they can pull out of these 5 points something that they need, Lord God, to be better Christians. And Father, we're asking that you touch it, bless it, add the increase. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, give God some glory, all right? Ushers. If our ushers can come right now, amen. Glory to God. If our ushers can come, listen, we're going to have our little time of tithes and offerings, amen. Go ahead and get yourself ready. And we want you to be a Barnabas. Don't you dare let people, everybody else, carry the load of this church. Don't you dare, hallelujah, around here like you own it. Y'all can come on to the altar. Come on to the altar. The mush is so shy. I ain't going to bring y'all up here with me, but I'm going to need y'all. All right. And we're going to get a little music. Hallelujah. And come on, bring your tithes and offerings to the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, my brother. Appreciate y'all. Appreciate y'all. Come on, bring your tithes and offerings to the Lord. Come on, be a Barnabas. Be an encouragement. Amen. Last service, a brother come up, tell me in. What's going on, Brother Elmo? Thank you, brother. Love you now. Hallelujah. Thank you, brother. Hallelujah, my people. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Good to see you there, brother. So good to see you. Thank y'all. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I'm going to put these in here. Brother came after the word. He said, I want to be a Barnabas. He dropped $2,000, amen, for the work of the church. Hallelujah. Want to be a Barnabas. Want to be a Barnabas. He's going to give. Hallelujah. And God's going to reward us as well. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for raising up a people. Good job. Good job. Teach them. Teach them the way. Teach them the way. Praise the Lord. Teach them. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank you, sister. Appreciate that, Miss Jeannie. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Anybody else? Anybody else? Glory to God. Appreciate you, sister. Hallelujah. Thank you, brother. Hallelujah. We need some Barnabases to help us with this work. To help us with this work. Hallelujah. Appreciate you that, young man. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Bless you, sister. Appreciate you. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Well, listen. Glory to God. Thank you, sister. You're a blessing. God bless you. Hundredfold. Father, bless these tithes and offerings, God, as your people have given. You said and you promised that you would give to them as they've been faithful, God, with little. Make them faithful with much. We pray a hundredfold blessing on these tithes and offerings. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, amen. Hallelujah. If y'all could follow Minister Anthony over here. Amen. He's going to take y'all where y'all need to be. Hallelujah. Saints of God, we're going to go ahead and conclude, but we never like to conclude without giving people an opportunity, amen, to know Jesus Christ as Lord. Listen, Barnabas gave people a second chance. Guess who else gives people a second chance? God. Yeah? Yeah? When we admit that we've sinned against him, when we believe that he died for our sins, when we believe that he rose again and that he's coming back, God says, whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved and forgiven.
Praise God that he's a God of a second chance. There's somebody here, you're not saved, you've done some wrong things in your life, amen, but you want to be forgiven. And I want to tell you here, at this altar, God will forgive you, God will save you, God will wash you clean. If you're here today and you want to be saved, if you're here today and you're a Christian, you want to come back to the gospel, come back to church and live the way you know you're supposed to be living. If you're here today and this message touched you in some kind of way and you say, God, I want to be like that in some kind of way. Listen, the altar is open. Come, pray with me, and then we're going to go home. Come on, come on. The altar's open. The altar's open. You can come. Don't worry about nothing. You can come. You can come. Don't worry about nothing. Hallelujah. 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 I want to be like that. I want to be like Barnabas. I want to be like Barnabas. You can come. You can come. You can come. You can come. I want to be forgiven. I want to be saved. I want to be like Barnabas. I want to be able to talk to people that I see. I want to be able to raise up new Christians. I want to be able to raise up leaders. I want to be that man. I want to be like Barnabas. I want to make a difference. Maybe I might not be the Pauls, but I could raise up a Paul. I want to be like Barnabas. And it all starts with giving your life to the Lord. Pray with me here. Say, God, thank you for loving me. I admit I've sinned against you, and I'm sorry. But I believe that you love me so much that you died on the cross for all my sins. You were buried, and on the third day, you rose with all power and all might. You're a good, good father, and I love you. Save me, Lord. Forgive me, Lord. And use me, Lord. Make me a Barnabas. Make me an encourager. Help me to lift people up and not drag them down. Lord, help me to be more open, to be more friendly, to develop people. Help me, Lord, to be a Barnabas. Use me for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, give God some glory. He's a good, good father, y'all. He's a good, good father. Hallelujah. Listen, I've kept you long enough, but you keep pressing. You keep pressing. Don't ever stop. Don't let nobody tell you that you can't do it. God is with you. May the Lord bless you. May he keep you. May he cause his face to shine upon you. May the Lord be gracious to you. May he lift up his countenance upon you and bless you with shalom, with peace. I pray peace in your body, peace in your mind, peace in your family. Woo! Peace! And blessings upon you. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. 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 Love y'all. Be blessed. Be blessed.